Exactly, exactly. And that's because you have, and this is what we try to expose in the film, you have these grifters, these so-called anti-racist types, DEI types, and this is their
grifters.
Goal. This is what they do. They try to make...
I don't want to hear... Okay, you guys, conservatives can't do this. They can't do this. After Tenet Media was caught taking $9.7 billion from Russia, and after Alex Jones lost a defamation lawsuit, after Giuliani lost a defamation lawsuit, after Fox News had to settle a defamation lawsuit, you guys can't say grifters anymore. You have lost that ability. You can't say it anymore. Every single side tries to claim Martin Luther King for themselves. I'm pretty sure if we look up Martin Luther King, systemic racism, I'm sure there's plenty of quotes that I can use against him, against Matt Walsh here. Like every single ideology tries to claim MLK for themselves.
It's scary when you think that these people, you know, actually do have power. And the other thing too, the other part of this is that
are those the same people that are even voting? Do those people even vote? They're probably too left to even vote for Kamala Harris, really.
They tell you if you're white, they're not remotely racist, they don't think in a racist way, they're not racist consciously or unconsciously. But that's become a real stick now.
These people show unconscious bias. I know these people, they don't think racistly, like, that's the point of it being unconscious. All right, we got Matt Walsh on Kamala Harris in racist area. Oh boy, I bet we're gonna get some intelligent takes from
thousands of dollars, and they just sit at your dinner table and call you racist for 2 hours. People pay for this.
You cannot separate yourselves from the bad white people.
The entire system has to burn. Whiteness robs you of your brain. People almost dare not talk about.
Are we still on all this woke stuff, really? This is what we're...
A racist. If you genuinely don't think that you are racist, then you're not.
Vice President Harris has been accused of adopting a fake urban accent to appeal to black and working class voters after delivering the same speech in two different voices just a few hours apart.
I tweeted about this. No one liked it, okay? This is the only time Big Show can actually add value to humanity, okay? Big Show, the worst fucking show ever made. Explain this, okay?
You don't have a code switch?
No. How does a code switch work?
In a fucking song, tricky, dude.
But let me break it down for you. As a black kid, you gotta learn this handy trick of social self-defense. You switch up your speak and give your manner a tweak depending on the audience. I'll be Will Smith witty or cool like Diddy or affable as you please. Cause when you're young and black, you develop a knack for putting the world at ease. It's called code switching, and I'm a master of the dial. I got a different me for every situation.
Like, wait. Like, you know it's bad when it's in fucking Big Show and somehow you still can't understand it.
You better thank a union member for paid leave. Thank unions for sick leave. Thank unions for paid family leave.
Many people making this observation have, of course, been accused of racism, as was former President Trump, claiming that Harris only recently started identifying as black. Whether it really matters or not is besides the point. What's striking is the taboo and how difficult it now is to ask questions about race without being promptly branded a racist. Matt Walsh's documentary, What is a Woman?, shone an uncompromising light on gender insanity, and his new movie, Am I a Racist?, turns its glare on diversity.
Is that what that movie did? Did it, though? That documentary? Remember when Matt Walsh, after making the documentary, said that he thought millions of American children were on puberty blockers when the number was like 3,000? Oh yeah, Vosh is code switching.
Still the capital, Virginia.
Destiny clowning on Vosh's accent slip up.
Yes.
I think my favorite Vosh clip of
AI?
All time.
It's when he's debating seven people, he gets possessed by...
When Vosh debates black people,
he gets
possessed by his Gusano slave-owning ancestors.
Actually politically represent my interests.
I'm not... My point here ain't about criticizing your vote. It's that only two people were going to be president. And there are only two real paths to FBI.
No. But those are two different... But...
You got that plantation riz. Hell yeah.
Equity and inclusion. And he joins me now. Matt, great to have you back on Uncensored.
That's how Nonfon got its start, baby. That's the first, actually was the first video on my channel. I had to fucking delete it. It got copyright. It got copyright claimed like 2 days ago. I don't know what I did to get it copyright claimed fucking 4 years after I reacted to it, but I did. Now Chuck E. Cheese sings WAP is the first video there.
Hi, Piers. Thanks for having me.
Just want to start before we get into the movie, which is great, by the way, as was the last one. Kamala Harris in that accent.
Really? Was it, Piers?
Is it racist to even ask why she's talking in a different accent?
No, I mean, of course not.
Many Democrat politicians in particular have done this, where they take on a different tone, a different accent, depending on the audience. It's just that with Kamala Harris, we get this really, especially the most recent thing, where it's the exact same lines she's giving a couple of hours apart, and it's just, of course, it's very noticeable. Everybody notices it, and it's insulting to the intelligence of the people that she's trying to pander to. And on top of it, as many have pointed out, you know, the accent she puts on, it sounds like Foghorn Leghorn or something. It doesn't even sound like what she's trying to make it sound like. So because she grew up in Montreal, Canada, And so she should just embrace that fact about herself and be authentic. That's all we're really asking for.
But in a way, it's a prime example. Right. I mean, in a way, it's a prime example of the kind of thing you talk about in the movie, which is that this sort of weaponizing of calling people racist whenever they raise any issue or question about anything related to race is a real problem in modern society. It's fueled by social media, by cancel culture, by all of these terribly insidious things which are going on. And what it creates is an atmosphere where people almost dare not talk about anything to do with race, the fear of immediately being called a racist.
Exactly. And that's because you have, and this is what we try to expose in the film, you have these grifters, these so-called anti-racist types, DEI types, and this is their goal, this is what they do. They try to make...
I don't want to hear... Okay. You guys, conservatives can't do this. They can't do this. After Tenet Media was caught taking $9.7 billion from Russia, and after Alex Jones lost a defamation lawsuit, after Giuliani lost a defamation lawsuit, after Fox News had to settle a defamation lawsuit, you guys can't say grifters anymore. You have lost that ability. You can't say it anymore. I should check Discord. What part of it? What?
These conversations completely, you know, fraught. They want you to be focused on it all the time. They come to you and they say, oh, you know, you think you're not racist because you think racism is a simple thing. If you don't hate people of other races, you think you're not racist. But actually, you are racist. And the fact that you think you aren't racist is just more evidence that you are even more racist than you thought. And they keep people...
What is this? I'm not watching fucking Country Balls video right now, bro. I don't care.
It becomes this like spiral where they're looking into themselves, constantly inspecting their own minds and their own motivations and sort of convincing themselves that they're actually racist when they aren't. And part of that is, again, making the concept of racism way more complicated and abstract than it actually is, because in reality, racism is just having a negative opinion of someone because of their race, thinking a certain race is inferior to yourself. That's racist. If you don't have that feeling about someone, then you're not racist. You might have other flaws, we all do,
right,
but you're not racist. Congratulations, you can just move on from that. But they don't want you to move on.
No, exactly right. And also it diminishes people who suffer from...
Some of the points that progressives make about people being racist is dumb. Like, that's true. But the issue is that Matt Walsh ignores any of the systemic racism that actually does exist in America. Do you think he makes fun of George Floyd's death? Do you think I can find a tweet of him making fun of George Floyd after George Floyd was killed?
We'll see. And their validity of their cause, because there's so much other stuff being thrown out there which just isn't racism. And so actual racism gets kind of lost in the wash. I want to just show viewers, if you've not obviously seen the movie yet, which is, I can't encourage them to do it enough, it's fantastic. This is a clip from the trailer for it.
Let's be clear, what's happening in this country, it's Nazism. Republicans are Nazis.
I don't know if he's talked about it in a way I can find easily, but Nonfon has 14 views. I almost guarantee you he's made fun of it, though.
You cannot separate yourselves from the bad white people.
Growing up in the 90s, I never thought much about race. Sure, you noticed, but never really seemed to matter that much. At least not to me.
Being a white, straight, cisgender man, it's the top of the pile.
I'm on the top of the pile. That's me. Am I racist?
I would really appreciate it if you left.
I'm trying to learn. I'm on this journey.
Can you please leave?
If I'm going to sort this out, I need to go deeper undercover. If I want to be an ally, I need to look like one.
What is racism?
Martin Luther King said not to judge people by
the... Martin Luther King said a lot of stuff.
Okay, I've seen the trip. Why does Piers Morgan just invite conservatives on his show to fucking promote their
movie? It's a great idea.
Matt Walsh pay for this? How much did Matt Walsh pay for this,
bro? You do this, but as I was watching it, it reminded me of something that was said by Morgan Freeman many, many years ago. I think it was a 60-minute interview. Let's take a little clip of what he said then.
I don't want a Black History Month. Black History is American history.
How are we going to get rid of racism?
Stop talking about it.
Or, I'm gonna stop. We just never mentioned it. There would be no racism ever again in America. Didn't consider that one.
I know you as Mike Wallace. You know me as Morgan Freeman.
I love the simplicity of that from Morgan Freeman. He wasn't saying there isn't racism, but he's saying the way to stop this incessant stuff that you've exposed in your movie is to just stop making it such a big issue all the time.
Democrats don't even do that. Like, this was a big issue. Critical race theory was like a fucking big issue like fucking 3 years ago, dude. Dude, we've moved past it, dude. We've moved past BLM. We've moved past all the critical race theory of it, okay? Like, I'm sure there's still some cringe people left out there, but like, holy shit, like no one, significantly less people care about this now than they did in like 2020 or 2021. We've moved on. There are still issues that need to be addressed with systematic racism, but we have, for the most part, moved on.
And you know, I also, we thought about that moment from Morgan Freeman when we were making the film. I don't know if you would ask Morgan Freeman today, would he say the same thing? I hope so. I'm not sure. And it really is that simple. Now, there are people who go too far on the other end and say, you know, actually, race, it doesn't even exist. It doesn't matter at all. It's completely irrelevant. I mean, it's a real thing. It matters. It's part of who you are. Just like I'm a man, that matters. It's part of who I am. But with race, it doesn't need to be the central focus of you know, every interaction that you have with someone. You can notice, oh, that person's of a different race. Fine. And then you just move on with your life. And the thing is, when you talk, we do this in the film, we go and talk to just normal people, both black and white, kind of living their lives a little bit outside of this DEI kind of world. And this is what you find, that it's not a major focus for them. And when you start asking things like, well, is America systemically racist? For these kind of normal people, the question almost doesn't make any sense to them. And
doesn't he kind of proving his own point there? That like the majority of Americans don't think about this, and that he's like interviewing like fucking 5% of the most like extreme like left-leaning people?
The mode that most people would be in if these
actually, you know, I almost guarantee you that he probably did interview like almost exclusively like socialist, like almost exclusively like pretty far left people.
But they won't, because that means less influence and power and money for the grifters.
Well, it's really interesting. It reminds me a little bit of the mental health debate, actually. Maybe that's the subject of your next movie. I don't know, but if not, it could be. Because a lot of people, young people in particular, they're almost encouraged to feel like there's something wrong with them. We live in a very victimhood-led society now, where it's almost a badge of honor to have something wrong with you. So people start to look for that. And I was thinking of that as I watched your movie. Different issue, but similar kind of mentality, watching these people who were just so desperate to see racism. And what struck me was quite sort of ironic was a lot of them seemed to be white, unless I was mistaking things. It didn't seem that diverse, equal, or inclusive in the actual group set up to do all this.
Yeah, there's no question that, and we noticed this making the film, that many people have noted it sort of anecdotally, that there's a lot of white women who seem to be driving this. Now, it's not all white women. There's also black women, and men too, but it does seem like white liberal women are overrepresented in this thing. And a lot of this stuff is targeting white liberal women in particular. Race to Dinner, you saw the trailer, where you've got these two, Cyra Rao and Regina Jackson, they go to dinner and you pay them thousands of dollars and they just sit at your dinner table and call you racist for 2 hours. People pay for this. And that is specifically for white women. White women are the only people invited to take part in that. And so a lot of it is really like targeting that demographic in a really interesting and kind of disturbing way.
And some of the stuff they were saying, Republicans and Nazis, you cannot separate yourself from the bad white people. White people feel frightened of black people every 10 seconds. Whiteness robs you of your brain. The entire system has to burn. This country is not saving. I mean, it was scary to listen to that stuff.
It's scary when you think that these people, you know, actually do have power. And the other thing, too, the other part of this is that...
Do they really have power? Are those the same people that are even voting? Do those people even vote? They're probably too left to even vote for Kamala Harris, really.
They tell you if you're a white person, they tell you, well, you're racist automatically. And then once they have you, and maybe you say, okay, well, I don't want to be racist anymore, and they give you a whole bunch of things to do, but then at the end of it, they say, oh, well, by the way, you're still racist. You can never not be racist. That's another thing we discover making the film. When you ask these people, like, at what point can I be not racist anymore? What do I have to do to not be racist? And what they'll tell you is, well, you could be, like, a little bit less racist, but you can never not be. You're always going to be racist because you're white, and whiteness is inherently racist. That's what they believe. So it's this, like, hopeless doom spiral.
Okay. Right? If that is actually what they believe, then those people are definitely not voting for Kamala Harris. Then those people are definitely way too far left to even, they're probably not even voting. They probably don't care.
And the only way to avoid it is just to ignore these people entirely, which...
I mean, did you work out what DEI really is at its core?
It's left-wing racial ideology, and this is its latest manifestation.
Do you think Matt Walsh supports the Electoral College? He probably does, doesn't he? Even though that's just DEI for white rural people? Like,
when DEI goes away, because it's being kind of... It has a negative connotation, that term, to most people now, which is good. But the people pushing it aren't going to stop. They're going to repackage it. Left-wing racial ideology. And that is really simple. It really is just the belief that whiteness is inherently evil, inherently racist. It's the cause of all of society's ills. And they're the oppressors. Everyone else is the oppressed. And that's the basic core idea of this thing. And everything just kind of recycles and revolves around that basic core idea.
You interview Wilfred Ryder, the author of...
Hold on. Let's see if I can... See if I can find it.
Now, he's an African-American man himself.
Oh, my support for the Electoral College is an absolute... Oh, so he does support DEI, just only when it benefits him. If we're kind of a situation where a person with more votes lost regularly, and despite wide or wide margin popular vote, it would be harder to continue arguing in favor of it. The system can survive an occasional popular vote. Electoral vote disparity. It can't survive frequent disparity. Then we... Okay.
He says that the epidemic of hate crimes is pretty well made up. And he uses examples of Jesse Smollett, the Covington Catholic school stories, and so on. I mean, the Smollett one to me was a really insidious story, where you have a very famous black American television star inventing effective lynching or attempted lynching by two people. And it turned out he fabricated the entire thing, paid them to do it, to portray himself as a victim of racism.
Exactly, and that's as many people point out, that, well, you know, if racism is really as prevalent as these people say, then you shouldn't have to go and invent a hate crime. You know, if you're let's say a non-white person and for some reason you want to be the victim of a hate crime, you would think that it'd be very easy to just walk outside and someone will commit a hate crime against you. That's the way they portray it. But it turns out that, you know, you have to kind of set it up for yourself. And, you know, I mean, really, this is why, in my opinion, the whole category of hate crimes legally shouldn't exist. I mean, the things we call hate crimes should be, like, if you beat somebody up, that's a crime. But trying to separate this particular category and treat it as this special thing, I think, is a bit absurd. And it ends up being used in a really arbitrary and ironically, I think, kind of racist and race-biased way.
One of the most ridiculous phrases, I think, in modern times is unconscious bias. And
really,
one of the people who use this a lot is Prince Harry, who obviously married a mixed-race woman, Meghan Markle, but he's always on about unconscious bias. His own royal family members showed unconscious bias. I know these people. They're not remotely racist. They don't think in a racist way. They're not racist consciously or unconsciously. But that's become a real stick now to beat.
These people show unconscious bias. I know these people. They don't think racistly. Like, that's the point of it being unconscious.
People with, even when you try your utmost to display to people that obviously you're not remotely racist, you don't judge people adversely because of their skin color, ethnicity, or anything else, that you're still basically guilty. And there's no real way of proving you're not. According to the rules of unconscious bias, because it's unconscious, you're biased.
Exactly, and that's what makes unconscious bias, I think you're right, makes it so insidious that it's unfalsifiable.
Insidious?
Because it's unconscious. So if you say, well, I'm not biased, they say,
we have evidence for this. Like, it's just an unfortunate fact of human psychology. Like, we've done the experience before where we fucking put people in MRI machines and we show them images of people of their own race and images of people their the opposite race, and we can literally see when we show them people of the opposite race, their amygdala activates more. The amygdala, that's part of like the brain that activates for fear. The majority of people have that response, and then if you're a good person, your prefrontal cortex counteracts that response. But humans are like literally psychologically wired to have like a negative response to someone who's part of the out-group, and being a different race is something that can be indicative of being part of the out-group, which activates your amygdala. Like we've done studies on this.
Well, exactly, it's unconscious. and then that puts these people in a position where they say, well, you don't even know what's happening in your own mind. You're not an authority on your own mind. I'm the authority, and I will tell you what is happening in your mind. And once you give them that
power, okay, what a great response. Yep, great.
Literally,
does he not know what the word unconscious means?
Your mind, then it's like they have everything.
It's completely insane. How have we got to this?
Yeah, you don't know everything that goes on in your mind. Correct. Some of it is unconscious. Yep, that is accurate.
I mean, I think we kind of go into that in the film and explore that in the film. I think it goes back to these grifters. Now, it's not entirely them, but I think you've got people who have discovered a lot of influence and power in keeping the kind of racial strife and division and all of that
and
suspicion and money. There's a lot of money. There's a lot of money to be made in that.
Neuroadaptation, facial reveals racial outgroup homogeneity affects in early perception. Like,
and so they're not going to allow, so they want to keep it there. They're not going to allow people to revert to the state of just kind of, you know, treating race in a sort of casual way where it isn't very loaded to them.
Racial bias and neural response to others' pain is reduced with other race contact.
They don't want to allow that because that means less money, less power for them.
I also think this whole thing of microaggressions that you talk about in the film is really interesting because so many people are aware.
How many people even care about micro, dude? This is like literally, does Matt Walsh like spend all day on like leftist Twitter and he like is his entire Twitter feed like people with like 20 likes on Twitter saying dumb shit and he gets so fucking angry about it he has to make a documentary every single time? Like,
yeah, they've got to be
really
more careful,
dude?
Perhaps in the way they talk and
really?
So on. And they try really hard. I'm talking about older generation people perhaps who never had to give as much thought. And they're really keen to try and say the right thing. And these microaggressions, you know, where are you from? Where were you born? Do you speak good English? This was University of Minnesota. These are all deemed microaggressions. You're Asian, how come you're not good at maths? University of Edinburgh. I don't see color, National Education Association, because apparently denies a person's of color's racial.
I feel like the Asian math one, it's a little understandable, but okay.
Unless it's intended in a derogatory way or a sneering manner, none of those things are aggressive. They're just questions people would ask. I mean, the whole royal family row, for example, about the potential skin color of Prince Harry's son, Archie, was apparently based around one of the members of the royal family saying, given Meghan Markle's parents, one's white, one's black, what skin color could the baby be? That's not a microaggression. It's not an aggression of any kind. Unless the question was, I hope it's not going to be too dark. That's a microaggression. That's racism. But to simply say, by the way, given the parents are different colors, what color might the baby be? What's wrong with that? Why wouldn't every family in that position ask that question?
Right. I mean, a lot of this stuff, asking someone where they're from, as you pointed out, is just that's just showing an interest in someone, that's being polite.
Right.
But part of this is that it's a damned if you do, damned if you don't. They set it up so it's a lose-lose, because with many of these so-called microaggressions, well, the thing, if you do the thing, you're racist, you're microaggressive. But if you don't do it, you could also be racist, because, you know, if you don't recognize that someone's from a different culture and you don't acknowledge it at all, well, now you've otherized them, you've excluded them, you've made them feel like they don't exist or something, you haven't affirmed their existence, you haven't taken an interest in their culture. That could also be racist. Really, it just depends on that person. It's like, how do they perceive it? Do they want you to ask, or do they not want you to ask? And you're supposed to know that going in.
Right.
And if you do the wrong thing, then it's automatically racist, apparently.
One of the criticisms you've had is that this whole concept of unconscious bias and so on, that actually a lot of people who are genuinely racist don't think they're racist. I mean, that is a real phenomenon, right? I know people who say racist stuff who would deny till their cows come home that they're actual racist, but I hear them, they are. They really are, I guess, unconsciously racist. How would you describe it?
But I think that if you genuinely don't think that you are racist, then you're not, because
you're
that's
racist.
Not in your mind. It's not what's motivated.
Do you think that's right?
Okay.
On that point, I would slightly pick you up on that, because I know people who
may
not
think
they're racist,
a little,
but they definitely
thank God.
Say stuff that is racist. They're judging people negatively from their skin color.
Well, I think you could have someone who is racist and denies it. That certainly can happen. I mean, there are racist people in the world.
Well, that's
all
what he's talking
about.
Okay,
anyone can be racist. And certainly some of them will deny that they are. Like, that is a thing that happens, sure. But the point is that there's only one authority. There's only one person in the universe who's an authority on what's in your mind. Mm. There's only one person who can really speak to that authoritatively, and that is you. And so if you genuinely don't feel any animosity to people based on their race, then you're not racist. You have many other flaws, I'm sure. You might even believe things stereotypically about races, but that's not racist in and of itself. And you're the only one who can speak to that. So if someone tells me they're not racist, then I'll just take them at their word on that. I'm not interested. I can't read their mind, and that's all that we can do. And then I'm just going to go on and live my life. I mean, I think that's the best way to approach most.
Do you think America's becoming...
Does Matt Walsh talk about anything important? Or is this all he does? I don't think I've ever seen anything important policy issue about Matt Walsh. Not Satire, Babylon Bee made a movie, January 6th, the Deadliest Day.
These are some
so
of the
retweeted
deadliest
this.
Days in history. But none of them compare to the most deadliest day.
No, show the Capitol Police letting them in.
January 6th. 2021. Coming soon in the most epic movie event.
No shot. They got all the. Oh my God. No shot. No shot. That they got all of these fucking conservative commentators to do it. Michael Knowles. Oh wait, is that Matt Walsh? No, it's not Matt Walsh. No. Oh. Brazil, CBC, Tim Walsh's family comes out against him. Our phones are listening to us. My racist review. Everyone. Oh, Twitter actually. No, Twitter's ahead of Rumble. Twitter chapters actually work. On Rumble, the timestamps don't do anything. Although they don't have like the chapter section thing like YouTube does. Yeah, I don't think he really talks about him. Oh, he's retweeting and wokeness. DEI.
I loved it. So
I don't think he talks about anything important.
Less racist decade by decade by decade.
I think it was. I think we kind of talk about in the movie that, you know, in the 90s, and the 90s was not a racial utopia in the United States. I realize that OJ, you know, race riots, that sort of thing did happen. But I will say that just anecdotally growing up in the 90s, very, very quick, diverse area, going to public school and all that, a lot of different races. It was not a major focus. And I think that we're kind of
the raw milks.
I think we're going backwards in a lot of ways. That it's now there's a resentment, there's a suspicion there to a much greater degree. 15, 20 years ago.
Why is Matt Walsh's camera so fucking laggy?
This is all quite intentional.
The George Floyd murder features in the film, obviously. The reaction to that was extraordinary, unprecedented.
Piers Morgan calls it a murder. Will Matt Walsh do that?
Hard to see any good in it. I saw a lot of bad. I mean, I saw whole communities being burned down. I saw innocent people being victimized en masse across the country.
In the real world, like 97% of the protests were peaceful, but okay.
Losing there, it was hysteria. I mean, what we saw was mass hysteria, and the response to that incident was not even close to reasonable. There's not any kind of reasonable conversation about it from the very beginning, and I don't think anything good came of it. That in and of itself is not responsible alone for a lot of the racial insanity we see today, because a lot of it was already happening. I mean, BLM existed years prior to that, but it certainly didn't help. I think that's for sure.
Well, I want to end by playing the iconic clip from the Martin Luther King speech. Let's listen to this.
I have a dream. children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream.
Wow. Crazy.
How do we get from that incredible speech to you having to make this movie?
Well, it's funny because I mentioned that to one of these race hustlers in the film. I just said, well, you know, so Martin Luther King said, are we supposed to? And she said, well, Martin Luther King said a lot of stuff, and then proceeded to, you know, to tell me why what the reality is in her mind. But I think it goes back again to like trying to
every single side tries to claim Martin Luther King for themselves. I'm pretty sure if we look up Martin Luther King, systemic racism, I'm sure there's plenty of quotes that I can use against him. Against Matt Walsh here, like every single ideology tries to claim MLK for themselves. I'm talking about institutional racism, saying that true racial equality cannot be achieved without radical structural change in society. Justice for black people will not flow in society merely from court decisions nor from foundations of political oratory. White America must recognize that justice for black people cannot be achieved without radical changes in the structure of our society. Like
where people are actually, you know, judged by their merits and all that sort of stuff. That's not the world that these people want to live in, because that takes a lot of this stuff out of the equation that they can use and exploit for their own power and benefit and gain. And they're just not interested in that. They don't want that. So I think that, look, I've been saying this for a while. They've been tearing down the statues in this country of, you know, founding fathers and all the white historical figures who existed prior to about 50 years ago. I think they'll get around to Martin Luther King Jr. I truly believe it.
Yeah.
We're going to see the first MLK statue come down in the next few years. I wouldn't be surprised if that happens.
No doubt.
Because even he, by their standards, even he is not woke enough.
We saw it actually with the statues of Parliament Square, Gandhi.
Why wasn't MLK woke?
It made no difference what their skin color was. They were all getting boarded up because people just wanted to tear them down. It's a great film. It's out on 13th of September, I believe. Theatrical release.
It's not even out yet. Oh, my God.
How do you feel about that?
I don't know if I go that far, but I mean, look, to have a movie in theaters is great. And this is the kind of thing, if you want to make films and conservatives, we want to try to take back the culture, we got to compete in these places, in places like movie theaters, and we'll see how it goes. I'm pretty optimistic.
Matt, great to have you on Uncensored. Best of luck with the film. Thank you.
Thank you.
Why did Matt Walsh even need Piers Morgan to promote it? Couldn't he just have contacted Tenet Media and asked for some sweet Russian bucks?